here, Bishop Fletcher. Thank God for this wonderful pastor. Let's thank God for the pastor. Thank God for all of the ministers, all of the elders, the deacons, the saints, and the friends. Greetings to all of our visiting pastors. God bless you, man of God. Bless you, man of the farm. God bless you. We thank God for all of the saints here, everywhere. Thank God for all of the saints. Why don't you give yourself a hand tonight? Let's go together.
Therefore, brother,
thought it was so interesting that a man of his stature, one who had been educated by the best, one who had hung around the best, one who had ran with the best. Here we are in the 12th chapter of Romans. He said, I beseech you, therefore, brother, one who at one point persecuted the saints. He was known for going in their homes and dragging them out. He was known for torturing them. He was a man who, when he walked in the room, people paid attention. He was a man whose name it called for you to focus on what he was doing. But now, in the 12th chapter of Romans, he said, I beseech you, therefore, brother, this man who was able to move crowds, this man who was said to have been present at the stoning of your first martyr, Deacon Stephen, this man was there, and now we see him begging. He said, I beseech you, therefore, brother. For a moment, he steps down from his title, his role as a lead servant in the newly organized church, and he comes to say, I beg of you.
Yeah. Yeah.
He said, I plead with you.
Yeah.
I admonish you. I wish for you nothing else. I want you, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice. What I love so much about his presentation is that he did not speak in general tones. He didn't say, I wish that they would present their bodies. He did not say, I want for the preacher that he or she would present her body. He did not say, for the deacon, I wish that he or she would present her body. But he said, I beseech you, therefore, brother, that you present your body, a living sacrifice. He said, not to the pastor, not to the missionary, not to the deacon, but he said it to you. I want you to know today that if we're going to make this journey, if we're going to walk out this change, if we're going to live out this deliverance, this chance to be all that he called us to be, if we're going to go get out and if we're going to see him revive us again, we've got to start presenting our bodies a living sacrifice.
Yeah.
I told you to shout before, you might not shout now. I was in my room today and I was flipping through pages and I said, God, I wanted to make them shout tonight. I just knew I was going to make them shout. It's Wednesday night. If I don't make them shout, they may not come back on Thursday and Friday. But God said, you got to say what I say.
Yeah. Yeah.
So instead of making this shout and instead of telling you about all the houses that he has for you and all the land that he has for you and all the wonderful inheritances that he has for you, he said, go tell them to present their bodies a living sacrifice. He said, and be not conformed to this world. He said, but be ye what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind. You know, this is an easy concept if it were just for Sunday morning. Lord have mercy on me. I said, this is an easy concept if it were just for Sunday morning. Because Sunday morning had a way to put us in a good mood. We get up, and when I was a kid, you knew it was Sunday morning because they were singing that song. They were singing Shirley and Caesar all around the house, and food had been cooking since Saturday night, and there was a hint of white diamond in the air, and my cousins were mortified because my auntie was burning their hair with that comb, and they didn't have flat irons, you know, but she was taking a comb, and she put it on the stove, and you could hear the crack of their hair, and she, I thought it was torture. I said, if this is what it means to serve God, I don't want it. On a Sunday morning, and we knew there was something about Sunday morning. We knew we were going to put on our good clothes on Sunday morning. We knew we would be greeted by the saints on Sunday morning. We knew that we would hear the sound of the big drum. Now, we didn't have all of this, but we had this big boom. You know, since Louise called him, all right, boom, 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 boom. we're going to hear those good old sanctified songs. I'm telling you, I love the music as it is. I like Tasha Collins. I love Loretta Curry's stories. I like all of them. I like Tyler Lady. I rock all of them. I'm just telling you, I love them. But there was something about that song, Run, Dumbo Fat.
By what? The renewing of your mind. God began to tell me that if you're going to reconcile your Sunday to your Monday, or maybe your Monday is a problem, maybe it's your Saturday night to your Sunday night, maybe it's your Wednesday night to your Tuesday night, if you're going to put them together, the first thing you're going to have to do is repent.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord, help us. I said the first thing you have to do is repent. Repentance is an uncomfortable conversation for many of us because we think we all got it together. You say, I've been saved all day long and I'm glad. Oh, look at me, I've got it together. But God told me to go wake up a church that forgot the importance of repentance. And I'm not just doing it in Fort Lauderdale, but when I went to New Jersey, God told me to tell them, we got to go back to true repentance. We've got to go back to a place where we understand the depth and the width of what real repentance is. Oh, repentance comes from one of the Greek words, manatoa. And this word means a transformation, a reformation, or a reversal of the way that we think.
Yes.
And I want you to know that real repentance is a change in the way that you think. I said real repentance is a change in the way that we think. Usually we think repentance is that, oh God, I messed up and got that lottery ticket in. And God, I know after I find out that I didn't win, I just want you to forgive me, oh God. And I repent for buying that lottery ticket. And I won't buy another lottery ticket until it hit 12 million again. But when it hit 12 million, I'll buy another lottery ticket and we'll figure it out from there. But that's not repentance. Oh, yes, I want to look at your face. That's far down here. We think that repentance is after we went on the date when God told us to stay home and the date didn't work out. And we say, God, I'm sorry. I won't do it again. I said, that's not repentance. But true repentance gets down in your bones. True repentance gets down in your soul. True repentance goes down underneath the exterior. It goes beyond the superficial things that you can see. But superficial, but true repentance is a transformation of the mind. If you can shout and you still cussing, you ain't been changed. If you can speak in tongues like you sir, and you still slipping and tipping, you ain't been changed. Oh, God Almighty. I wish the preacher would need to talk like that. If you can play the music and still go listen to the Migos and Erykah Badu and Beyonce and I don't even know Lil Wayne and Big Wayne and Harajuku Barbie. Come on. You can go listen to all that. I'm going to just tell you ain't been changed. Oh, if you can use the same tongue to sing all of that and then turn around and say, I bless the Lord at all times. Praise shall forever be in my mouth. I want to call you what it is. I'm going to tell you you're lying because you ain't been changed. All right, that's all right. I want you to know that what people are always saying, we need to go back to the old landmark. We need to go back to how we used to do it. And we always talking about the church has changed. I want you to know it's not the church. It's not even that we need to go back. It's that we need to go back to being changed.